Okay, I have the great pleasure of introducing our next speaker. That's Fran Bagenal, who's from the University of Colorado. Fran has, she's a brilliant scientist. She has great breadth of interest as well. She was studying the solar corona here at HAO. She studies planetary magnetospheres, and she's been involved in numerous discovery missions, Voyager, Galileo, New Horizons, Juno. And she's going to be talking to us about planets, she's including Pluto, yay, Jupiter, and many others. Thank you.
This could be titled, and now for something completely different. Okay, thank you. Okay, so I have this rather bizarre title, and it will become clear in a minute what that means. But before we go there, I want to show you some history, since it's the history session. I came to HAO in 1987 for a year as a visiting scientist, partly because I wanted to rock climb, partly because I wanted to hang out with this character on the left, since my husband, and I hung out with a bunch of people here. I came as a planetary scientist working in space plasmas, particularly magnetospheres, but I got interested in the solar corona and worked a bit on the corona for a while until I realized I was stretched from the sun to Pluto and something had to give. But I hung out with a lot of people here at HAO. I had a great time, both work and play. And in particular, I'd like to thank many years of skiing with my friend Alice Lisinski. So we've remained friends over the years, even though I moved on to the University of Colorado after a year. So what you really want to hear, I suspect, is apart from my anecdotes of these characters, is about the missions that I've been involved in, the New Horizons mission to Pluto, and particularly, and also Juno. I'm going to start off explaining a bit what this bizarre title is of my talk. I talk a bit about the comparison of other planets compared with the Earth. Actually, I don't really count the Earth as a planet, right? I mean, you know, it's where we live. And so when we look at the Earth, we understand over many years what's going on in terms of the solar wind driving a lot of activity here on the Earth, and in particular the storms that occur and drive strong auroral patterns are associated with the solar wind driving this large-scale global convection system, as was first described by Dungey in 1961, but where the solar wind is coupled to the planet. And Art Richmond described clearly what was going on in terms of the response of the ionosphere in the upper atmosphere to this solar driving convection driven by the solar wind. And you'll see that we have, looking at the polar region, we have the conventional picture, more or less right, is that we have an open region connected to the solar wind inside the main auroral oval region and a closed magnetic field region outside the auroral region. So this is the picture that we have for the Earth. And what I want to show to you is to show that for the Jupiter, although it's much bigger than the Earth, all of the Earth's magnetosphere would fit within the planet Jupiter. This picture, just taking what we have at the Earth and translating it to Jupiter, just making it bigger, is wrong. And so I want to tell you that Jupiter is not like the Earth. And this is the various ways in which it's very different. First of all, we know that the moon Io, the volcanic moon that spews out about a ton a second of gases that become ionized and form the magnetosphere of Jupiter, this is coupled to the rotating planet, rotates every 10 hours, and the main region, looking down at the equatorial region of the magnetosphere, is dominated by rotation with the planet, not a large-scale convection system that we have driven by the sun as we have at the Earth. Now, this is important when we think about the aurora, because this bright aurora, as observed by Hubble and other ways, but particularly by Hubble, has got nothing to do with the solar wind. It's mostly driven by what's going on inside. And this auroral oval has nothing to do with the solar wind open-closed boundary. In fact, nearly all of the magnetosphere is closed. We have a region with EO-generating plasma, which moves outwards. And as it moves outwards, it remains coupled to the planet and spins. But at some point, it's hard for the planet to maintain this rotation. And the parallel currents that flow through, coupled to the planet, begin to break down. It's hard to drive these currents. There's very little plasma up here. And maybe this relates to this debate between Birkeland and Chapman that was discussed this morning, that maybe the problem of how do you drive parallel currents in a plasma is related to this issue. There's debates and discussions about how these currents can and sometimes cannot flow. And indeed, we believe that the processes happening at these polar regions may be related to the processes that happen at the Earth, where you develop parallel electric fields, you develop potential regions, and so on at high latitudes. But the point I want to make here is this whole volume, this whole region, is in the inner third of the magnetosphere, and it's got nothing to do with open-closed and nothing to do with the solar wind-driven system. So what we have here is, we're again, looking down again, we have this rotation-dominated system, and at some point, the magnetic field, either due to a ballooning mode or centrifugally driven instability, the plasma gets ejected down the tail. We have an erratic, irregular X line in the tail, very variable, and material gets ejected down the tail. Where there is an interaction with the solar wind is entirely via a viscous layer where there's small-scale intermittent reconnection on the boundary. And so this leads to a view that I have, that this is largely a comet, this is a sketch, but you can think of now the magnetosphere of Jupiter having an inner rotation-driven region of EO-driven material blobs going down the tail. But in fact, when we look on the boundaries, we're not seeing a globally solar wind-driven convection system, but the solar wind is hung up by the viscous interaction on the boundaries. And so I would argue that we have something that's more like a comet, and the Juno mission that will go into orbit on the 4th of July next year will be investigating this. It will use gravity and magnetic field measurements to measure the interior structure, trying to understand the dynamo, and the microwave observations will try and understand the clouds. But for me, what's important is the orbit, where we fly over the poles, under the radiation belts, and out again, will be an opportunity to explore the polar magnetosphere and to address what's causing the aurora and try and understand this coupling between the magnetosphere and the ionosphere and how different it is to the situation at the Earth, even though the microphysics may be similar, and will perhaps address the very question that I'm posing, that maybe Jupiter should be thought of as a colossal comet, tadpole, rather than an Earth-like magnetosphere. Okay, so now let's move right out to the outermost part of the solar system, jump from Jupiter to Pluto, which of course has been a lot of attention in the press recently. So one thing to remember on this 248 years orbit of Pluto around the Sun, since its discovery back in 1930, it has not gone halfway around yet. And so we really did not know going into this mission exactly where Pluto was. We knew where it was in the sky, but we didn't actually know its radial distance to within a diameter. So one thing to think about when we're about to fly by. The other thing to realize is as we started thinking about proposing this mission around the time of perihelion in 1989, which we celebrated at CU with a keg of beer on the lawn, something we couldn't do these days. But back then we did, and around then we found out that Pluto was not alone. Before 1992, we had started struggling to try and get a mission, but it was difficult to sell when all you had was little Pluto out there. But once we started to find the Kuiper Belt, it was easier. Because indeed, as this movie shows, the discovery, starting with Pluto and then many other objects, you can begin to see this discovery from 1992 onwards, many, many objects out there, some large, some small, a whole variety of objects. We realized that Pluto was not alone, that there are many objects out there, and this now is the third zone of the solar system, the Kuiper Belt. And as this turns on its side, you will begin to see that not only are these in eccentric orbits, but they're scattered out of the plane of the planets into this broad disk. So what did we know back then, or what do we know before we started this mission? Well, we knew there were many of these objects, different colors, different sizes, some with moons, some without. And for comparison, here is Ceres, the largest object of the asteroid belt that the Dawn spacecraft has just gone into orbit around. And you can see that the Kuiper Belt has a variety of things, and Pluto being just one of several large objects. This is what we knew about Pluto before the mission. We knew their rough sizes, their comparative sizes. The center of mass is, in fact, outside Pluto, and so this is rotating around each other, around this center of mass here. You'll see the difference in color, Charon grayish, Pluto reddish, brownish. And you'll see the temperature is really cold. I don't care what units you use, that's bloody cold. Density is about 50-50, so that means half rock, half ice, density of 2 times the density of water. And so we knew that there's a substantial amount of ice on the outside, rock on the inside for both these objects. And for scale, here is the Earth, and you can see this is indeed a small planetary system. And this is about the right separation, about the full diameter of the Earth. We also knew beforehand that Pluto had an atmosphere, looking at a star going behind Pluto back in 1988. We could see it wasn't blinking out as the star went behind, but there was a slope to this blink out that gave us some sense of the pressure, 3 to 50 millionths of the pressure in this room. Same sort of composition, but dominated by nitrogen, some methane, and some carbon monoxide. With a temperature of about 50 degrees. So these are the things we knew before. We also suspected that Pluto's atmosphere is escaping, add a little bit of greenhouse gases, CO2 and methane, in the outer layers, heating it up with a weak gravity. You end up with this really substantial, large atmosphere about the size of the Earth escaping away at a rate of about 500 tons a second. So that's equivalent to about a kilometer of ice over the 4 billion years of Pluto. So Pluto's not disappearing. I mean, it's still substantial, but the atmosphere is indeed escaping. An atmospheric escape is an important process that we can compare what's happening at Pluto with other places. What I was interested in was how the weak solar wind, 1,000 times weaker in flux than here at the Earth, how does this interact with this escaping atmosphere? And this is what we drew a sketch of, a bow shock and an interaction region, but it's total guesswork. Okay, so time for a mission. Back in 1989, I started working with Alan Stern on planning a mission to Pluto. This is when I had just joined the faculty at the University of Colorado. And we went out to propose a mission. It took a while, but eventually we persuaded NASA to have a competition. We competed with a different group, we won, and the New Horizons mission was selected. Here are the instruments on board. We have a variety of cameras, high resolution and low resolution infrared, wide angle UV spectrometer, ALICE, a particle detector, SWAP, solar wind, energetic particle, PEPSI, a radio antenna used for communication with the Earth. We'll also use to do radio sounding of the atmosphere and ionosphere. But the most important is the student dust counter, built, tested, operated, and worked by University of Colorado. Colorado students, and this detects particles of dust as we fly out through the solar system. So, those of you who have not heard me talk before, I challenge you to tell me, how many particles do you think per day have we detected on our way out to Pluto? What do you say, 1,000? Million per day? More than that? 10? One? What? About one every 3 days. So space is indeed empty. There's not a lot of stuff out there. And this material is, we believe, produced by the grinding up of Kuiper Belt objects that this dust comes in. It takes about a million years to go from the Kuiper Belt into the sun, but is dumping, I think the number, if I get it right, is about 6 tons a day of material that's hitting the sun. Well, of course, it doesn't really make a lot of difference to the sun, but this is material that we now have been able to analyze and understand how much material is coming from the Kuiper Belt inwards. Now, before we set off on our travels to Pluto back in 2006, when the spacecraft was launched in January, just beforehand, we detected with the Hubble Space Telescope two more moons, not just Charon, but Nix and Hydra. And then on our way out to Pluto, we detected another two, so we now have five moons, a total of six objects to explore. So we had to adapt our strategy. Now, remembering after this 9.5 years, we get there. This is a 4.5 hour round trip light time for the data. We had to plan everything in advance, tell the spacecraft what to do, let it get on with it, and then talk back to the Earth. And you can see the scale here. This is a 10 minute tick. So this is about a 2.5 hour period where the spacecraft is moving at 33,000 miles an hour, and we had to tell it what to do, and then sit back and wait. Well, while we were sitting back and waiting, we did various things with all the press and so on, the big hoopla that was happening at the APL, Applied Physics Lab, Operations Center, and so we did things like take pictures of all the women on the team. And I wanted to show you this, given the fact that we had a whole morning of largely male scientists, I'll be quite blunt about it, I thought I'd show you a few women. About 30% of the team, which I think is quite impressive. Then eventually, in the evening, we got news. The spacecraft talked back to us, spoke to the mission operations manager, Alice Bowman, and told us that not only was the spacecraft well, but it was the data on board, the memory was full. And we jumped in the air, and this picture was spread around the world. Anyway, good fun. It was great news after 9.5 years of getting there. So what did we see? I'm sure you've seen some of these pictures, but I can't resist showing you a few more of them. And what you can see is, yes, there's dark areas, we knew that, light areas, but now we can see details and structures here, which are very interesting. We see craters in what seems to be older regions, and then a fresher region, which is this white heart, or this white ice region. And it seems as if this is relatively fresh. There's some melting on the edges, you can see, or evaporation. But when we look up close, we see a really complex world with all sorts of things. And perhaps the most dramatic is when we see this polygonal structure in this heart-shaped icy region. Now, this is nitrogen ice. And in fact, Dennis Gallagher said to me this morning that we have to think of the solid stuff is water ice, and that's like granite. It acts like the rock. Whereas here, nitrogen ice acts like the water on Earth. And so we have a weathering system that happens due to nitrogen ice, and then the rock or the solid stuff is in fact water ice. Now, we think that this polygonal structure is produced by convection within this ice, maybe 4 kilometers thickness of nitrogen ice, but the viscosity is very sensitive to temperature. And so you can drive convection, maybe even from cooling at the top rather than heating from below, but you have a convective system where you're having a turnover of ice. Now, you see no impact craters. This is relatively fresh material with active volcanism occurring. So water ice acts like rock, and when we look at the mountain region, Hilary Montes, Norgay Montes, these are, of course, temporary names which the IAU has not approved yet, but damn it, they will if we have our way. Anyway, these are the ones. I should say the IAU decided we had to call all of the things we find on Pluto after death and dying. Cheerfully, we decided otherwise. So we have rocky mountains, not made of rock but of ice, very solid, rising up about 11,000 feet, comparable indeed to our Rocky Mountains. And so you can see all sorts of interesting things with these impact craters and the older regions, and then the nitrogen ice doing things like filling in the craters. So you can see now structures that are associated with glacial sort of features that we see at the Earth. So sometimes there are things that look like icebergs. These are probably water, ice acting like rock. Perhaps similar to the sort of things we see at the Earth, where the granitic rocks stick up out of ice in the same sort of fashion. And indeed, we can see flows in Sputnik Planum of this glacial material flowing around some of the bits sticking up. And then you see the unrounded material, which is older, with impact craters that has been maybe worn down by some of these glacial structures. So not only does Pluto have all this geology, its active behavior, but so does Charon. We can see cracks, ridges. We can see impacts. It has a geology less active, but evidence of glaciology, more like a ice rock surface, ice acting like rock. So this movie was made showing the flyby. Here we have Charon and Pluto orbiting around the center of mass. We fly by Pluto. We get to see the complex geology of Tombo Regio. And then we see the sun go behind Pluto and then Charon. So we were able to use these solar occultations to make measurements of the atmospheres of these objects. So we first looked for an atmosphere of Charon, and we didn't see it. We see a sharp blinking out of the UV light as the sun went behind Charon. That confirmed no atmosphere for Charon. But when we look at Pluto, we see a gradual blinking out, blinking all the way down here and back up again, of the light behind Pluto, telling us that there's an atmosphere, a substantial atmosphere, as we knew, but this atmosphere is extensive. The exobase is out several Pluto radii out beyond. So it's a very tenuous atmosphere that extends a long way because of the weak gravity of Pluto. We also found hazes when we look through these occultation measurements. And so what we think is happening is that a small amount of methane in the atmosphere under the UV light is undergoing photochemical reactions, turning into things like ethylene and acetylene, and further into these tholins, or complex hydrocarbons. And this is the orange, brown, black materials that accumulate on the surface. They rain out onto the surface and make those very old, dark regions. And this indeed explains why Pluto is a reddish brown, while Charon remains gray, because without an atmosphere, these photoreactions are not happening in the atmosphere and raining down. So what about this Pluto and a comet story? Well, Alan Stern got very annoyed when I started comparing Pluto to a comet, because he wanted to point out that the Pluto is substantially larger than the comet. So I show for scale an exercise ball and a grain of rice to give you a relative size of comet P67, blah, 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 CG. I can't pronounce it, sorry. And here we have, to scale, Pluto and the rubber ducky, otherwise known as comet P67. And so you can see this is a substantial difference in scale. So this is important when we're thinking about the effect of the solar wind interaction with their escaping atmosphere. Essentially, no gravity on the comet allows escaping atmosphere and a substantial region of interaction of the solar wind with that escaping atmosphere. Mars, on the other hand, does have an escaping atmosphere. Because of the higher gravity, that region is much more tightly confined to the planet. And we think that Pluto, the situation is just right, of course. It's a compromise somewhere between these two, where the weaker gravity means it's a more extensive interaction region, and yet it's not fully extending out into space. In fact, our recent results that have just been on the ground about a week suggest Pluto is probably more like Mars than it is like the comet, though they both have tails. We know that with a weak magnetic field at 33 AU, that there's a very kinetic interaction. This is a cartoon based on a hybrid code of Peter Delamere. But what we think is happening is the gyro radii of the pickup ions are very large, and so the scale size of the bow shot, the scale size of the interaction region, the inertial ion inertial length is quite large compared with that interaction scale. So it's a very interesting, from a plasma physics viewpoint, how this interaction works. And so it's been quite a ride, many years, 26 years of getting this mission all the way to Pluto, and 9.5 years all the way out there, 2.5 hours of actual data, and then another 15 months of getting the data down, and it's been a big event. So thank you very much.
Thank you, that was fantastic. Questions?
I understand that New Horizons is going on to another target now. What do we know about that target?
So we've always planned to go on to a second target. We planned to go on to something, this potential target one. The flyby is probably going to be January, and this is the size of that target. It's relatively small compared with Pluto, large compared with the comet. And this is the size relative to the Cape. But you can see we actually got approval on Friday. And this is the cartoon that NASA produced. And I think it's probably completely different from the cartoon. But this is the plan. So yes, we are go for the next comet. the next Kuiper Belt object. Who knows if it's a comet?
So I think I got it straight now. Pluto was a planet, was a comet, but now it's a planet. But Jupiter's a comet. Now, so in a hypothetical, if Jupiter were larger and hotter and very close to the sun, would it still be a comet? Or would it have a magnetosphere like more similar to the Earth with the auroral processes?
It probably would not have a moon EO, and so there would be not be a huge internal source that's driving it. It would probably not be spinning, and so indeed, if Jupiter were a hot Jupiter, we think of these exoplanets, they are probably more like a terrestrial magnetosphere than like the rotation driven, internally driven Jupiter. Yeah, more like Venus. Yeah, good point.
Mine's quick. You have a few-hour flyby of Pluto, and I had heard that because of the bandwidth restrictions, it's going to take like a year and a half to download the data. Is that correct?
Yeah. So the data are coming down at 4 kilobits per second compared with 50 megabits per second for your cell phone. So, yeah, it's a few images per DCN, 8R downlink, and so it'll take 15 months or so to get the data done.
One question to Pluto. I know there have been discussions of a second mission, and in answering the question of how to finance this with these results, could you extend the claim of finding hydrocarbons to that there's actually oil on Pluto?
Oh. That's a great idea. There is biology. I think that's extremely unlikely with a 50 Kelvin temperature and with the water being solid. But the idea of oil, go mining the oil, is we should try that, yes.
Then more seriously to your Jupiter presentation, how does the interaction of a CME reaching this different magnetosphere look like?
So we've seen some events, and we will. This is something that Juno will be able to look at. We'll be able to monitor the solar wind and actually measure this. We hope the CME goes by at the time. This is a very compressible magnetosphere because we've got a high beta plasma inside where the plasma pressure dominates over the magnetic field pressure. And so we think it's very compressible. So a CME goes by, it compresses it, it ejects more of the plasma down the tail, and then it just expands back out again and continues rotating around. So there's no strong evidence for a strong response of the aurora to solar wind. There is some response to solar wind interaction, but there's nothing like the response that you get at Earth from strong CMEs going past in terms of auroral phenomena. But you do certainly compress the magnetosphere and maybe expel a lot of that eogenic plasma down the tail.
Let's thank Fran again for a wonderful talk.